Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members. We've already talked about the fact that 54% of our property tax bills are for our public schools. Rather than focusing on local jurisdictions by limiting their tax rates with minimal to no result in actually affecting the taxes, many of us have recognized, as Chairman Bonin did when we began debate today, that real property tax reform means real school finance reform. In 2006, some of us were here, most of you were not, but we did a comprehensive tax compression for local relief when the rate was reduced and the state committed to increasing their funding. That was the result of a blue ribbon committee headed by John Sharp and appointed by Governor Perry. Their final report indicated that one of the benefits of their proposal was that the state would be picking up 50% of the cost of public education. I laid out a HAR in appropriations this session modeled after one that Representative Bert Solomons proposed to get us back to that 50% goal. Back in 2006, 16 of our current House members and several who are now in the Senate signed on to that, but this HAR didn't pass in 2006 and it didn't make it out of committee in 2017. Unfortunately, as predicted, though, the state's share has once again eroded to what's projected by the LBB to be down from close to 50% to 37.7% by the second year of the 18-19 biennial budget. This is all about the state benefiting from increases in property values. As we've already been talking about, we actually count on and calculate this property value and hence property tax increase in our budget in Rider 3 in the TEA bill pattern. We count on those additional local dollars, but not state dollars, to fund population growth of 168,000 students in the upcoming biennium. It also helps fund the additional $1.4 billion for charter schools, because you've got to remember that charters have no local taxing authority and get their entire per pupil funding from the state. While our traditional school districts, which educate about 94% of our students, only get a portion, about a third, from the state. Those local additional property taxes also allow the state to back out almost $3 billion that it would have owed, allowing the state to use those local property taxes collected for the purpose of funding public schools or other state programs. If you compare funding in the 16-17 budget to 18-19 budget that we just passed, we're counting on an additional almost $7 billion from local property taxpayers to pay for our schools. This actually represents one of the largest de facto tax increases in recent history. State law requires public education to be substantially funded through state revenue sources, but contributing a third hardly qualifies as substantial. This amendment says that we must stop the practice of shifting the costs to homeowners and require the state to maintain 50% of the cost of free public education before we further start ratcheting down local jurisdictions. For reference, if the state had maintained 50% of the share of total funding for schools from 2010 to 2019, local property taxpayers would have seen a reduction in their taxes of $28 billion. So we can make that commitment today to start solving this problem in a real way instead of going after local jurisdictions by passing this amendment, which basically says that we will not enact this act until the state is assured that it is reaching 50% of the cost of public education. I move adoption.